usual for us. For those of you who haven't been to one of our center meetings, we usually hold them on the Friday nights, starting at 8. But because of the timetable of everyone and our speaker as well, we'd like to, felt we could try to move it forward to the Wednesday and to 7 o'clock to accommodate everyone. For those who are here and don't know who the speaker is, sorry about that, but you picked the winner of the night. The speaker is Dr. Halton Arc, an astronomer of great note, and also been around for a long, long time. I understand he's born in 1927, and got his degree in the mid-50s or so, and then worked at the Mount Wilson Palomar Observatories, now the then later called the Hale Telescope on Palomar Mountain. And in the mid-80s, he went to the Max Planck Institute in Munich, where he's been ever since. For those of you who are stimulated by his talk, there's a couple of books out. The one that is in our library, Ottawa Public Library, is the older version of the book, Quasars, Redshifts, and Controversies. And the new book that's out is Progress in New Cosmology Beyond the Big Bang. So I encourage you to look into these titles when you leave this meeting. The speaker is Dr. Arc. He's going to be talking. He gave a talk earlier today, so he's probably, I don't know if he's going to redo old jokes or just improve on old ones. I'm sure from talking to him over at dinner, he sounds like it's going to be a very interesting presentation. And I'd like you to all join and let us welcome him to Ottawa.
Thank you. I will continue on the subject that I was talking about earlier this afternoon, and that subject is the association of quasars with peculiar galaxies. And the reason this is so important is because if quasars, these very high redshift star-like objects, if these quasars are really physically at the same distance with low redshift galaxies, then that means there's something wrong with the normal way in which astronomers normally measure distances. Because astronomers, the majority of astronomers, consider quasars to be out at the edge of the universe because of their high redshift, the amount which the lines are shifting to the red. So these associations of quasars with nearby galaxies become extremely critical. And if these are correct, if these are true, then we have to, the field has to go back and redo essentially all of extragalactic astronomy. The Big Bang, the expanding universe, is in question. In fact, it's untenable. And this is why the attention on these particular objects. Now, the object that I'm going to start off talking about this evening is not one I mentioned this afternoon. It's a new one. And I was just still reducing the observations as I left. but it is so interesting that I want to show you where I've gotten so far. These observations are taken in the X-ray region. And the X-ray region has heretofore been unavailable to astronomers. But now, with the advent of space telescopes, with the orbiting telescopes and the satellite, it's possible to do this. I was fortunate to wind up in Munich at the Max Planck Institute for Astrophysics, which is right next door to the Max Planck Institute for Extraterrestrial Physics, which is responsible for putting up the X-ray satellite called ROSAT, that's Rentgen Observatory, Rentgen X-ray, the German for X-rays. And it's certainly the finest X-ray telescope up, and it's producing new results and new wavelengths that we've never seen before. I was very fortunate to get these observations down. They come down a little tape cassette, and then you put them in a computer and reduce them. And I'll show you some of those reductions and what they show of some of these critical objects with quasars around galaxies. But first of all, I want to introduce this galaxy, which I think is a very interesting galaxy, and one of the best examples of a galaxy ejecting matter. And I must say that when this galaxy was discovered, I was working at the Royal Observatory in Edinburgh, and the United Kingdom Schmidt survey was in progress from Australia. And I was there cataloging peculiar galaxies, and I was sort of the expert in peculiar galaxies. And one day, somebody came to me and said, look, here's this galaxy we discovered on the Schmidt survey place, and it looks as though it has these faint little objects coming out of it. Well, I was the typical expert, you know, I know all about these things, so I looked at it and said, no, it's a plate defect, it's nothing. Well, of course, it turned out to be the most famous and the best example of a real jet galaxy. And later on, I was able to get photographs at the CTI telescope in Chile. As a matter of fact, I had a whole test run, and I spent a lot of it observing this galaxy, and I got very deep photographs. So the first slide will show you why this is such an unusual galaxy. Can we have the first slide, please? It, on the original place, these things are very, let's see. These are quite faint, but this is a superposition of many galaxies, and there's been star removal performed on this. This is a very nice image processing technique where you remove all the faint stars, and all just the bright stars are left. But and it's to emphasize these jets that come out. This is a famous dogleg jet. It comes out and then suddenly makes a right angle. People have asked me why that jet makes a right angle, and I have to tell you, I don't know. That's a big unknown. However, there's this strong jet that comes out in this way and this direction here, and then I think you can see this faint counter jet. See, there's always tends to be a jet and a counter jet. I'll show you this same galaxy in color now. And this was done again by the same imaging processes at JPL, a jet propulsion laboratory in Pasadena. And you can see it in color. Okay. And you notice, and this becomes very important in what I'm going to say, that the jets on this side are strong and blue, and on this side they're weak and red. And this is going to be quite important. Let's go to the next slide, please. This is this is a color picture of the interior to show you what an active galaxy is. There's hot spots in here. It's called a hot spot nucleus galaxy. It's a dark spiral. And these beautiful spiral arms coming out. And then, as you can see, the faint jet goes up and through there. And it's actually broken through the arm here. It, you can see the arm is sort of fractured. And then there's a missing point in the arms on the opposite side, which really shows that something physically has gone off from the nucleus of this active galaxy, with a lot of energy in the nucleus, and gone out on either side in a kind of an ejection. Now, this was all very nice about galaxies and these mysterious jets and so forth, but the breakthrough really came when the first X-ray telescope went up, which was called the Einstein Laboratory, and it produced some rudimentary X-ray results, which I think are next are shown on the next slide. And here's the X-ray results. You see these little isotopes indicate where the X-rays are coming from. Well, there's a light coming from the galaxy itself, right in the middle, and then there's little spots around there. They're numbered 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And when somebody, actually they bootlegged this observation to me, they came to me and said, we found these spots and they may be something significant, what do you think? And I went to the telescope and identified them optically, and they turned out to be faint blue stars. And then I was going to Chile at the time, this is a southern hemisphere object, so I got the redshifts, these things, and they turned out to be quasars. And that was very exciting, because to find six quasars so close together and so close to an active galaxy Well, the chance of this happening by accident is just negligible. So you can just tell by looking at this picture and knowing that these are quasars, you know that they have to be physically associated with this actual galaxy. Okay, now, just as I say, now this new gross X-ray telescope has gone up, and I have observations, these new observations, and I have one transparency which I can show you, which I just recently had made up. And here it is. You see I've outlined these jets in white, and then these colored spots are all the new X-ray observations. You can see they're much better resolution and much crisper, and we know a lot more about it. I must say straight off that this object is normally the brightest quasar in the group. But for some extraordinary reason, just at the time of this X-ray observation, this thing had dropped by a factor of 30 in intensity. These quasars are so variable. Their intensity fluctuates up and down so much that this particular object was almost dropped out of sight on this particular observation. I'll show you some others where it's up at its normal range, which makes it one of the brightest quasars in the group. So now we have this amazing situation where we have this active galaxy shooting out these optical jets, and we have these strong X-ray sources, bang, 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 and these bright ones are essentially all confirmed as confirmed quasars, redshifts about 5/10 to 1 in that range. But you see there's something a little strange here, in the sense that these quasars are all on one side. Now the question is, why are they all on one side of this galaxy? Now, I should just back up just a minute and say that over this field, for several years, I went down to Las Campanas in Chile and measured quasars all optimal degree. And this is only about 11 arc minutes in here. I measured a huge area in here, measured all the quasars in there. And I came up with 31 quasars. So that there's a concentration of about 31 quasars in this direction of the sky, and most of them must belong to the galaxy. So in this region here, the density of quasars is 20 times the normal density of any region of the sky. And frankly, if I were, as a professional astronomer, if I were another professional astronomer and looked at this and I saw this concentration of quasars, I would have to say, well, that's it. These quasars really belong to the galaxy, and we have to re-examine our notions of what makes redshift, what causes the redshift. Because these are certainly not expanding away with these velocities. But in this new in these new X-ray observations, I just started to investigate this question of what causes the bright quasars to be all over on one side. And this is one of the latest plots that I got out from a computer. And you can see the following thing. And that is that here are the bright quasars, the bright X-ray sources, I'm sorry. And of course this one is temporarily absent. So there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 7 of them up here. And there are fainter X-ray sources down on this side. There's 8 of them here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. But they're much fainter, and they're also much harder. And by much harder, I mean is that they're higher energy, the spectrum is more concentrated in the higher energy. And so immediately, it gives you the idea that what might be happening here is that there is some absorption, in this case it would be hydrogen absorption, which is in a plane from the galaxy, which is obscuring the quasars on this side and not on this side. And what this would be like is if the galaxy was pointed at you like this, and on the top you saw them unobscured by the plane, and underneath they were obscured by the plane. Now, this looks like, I think, a reasonable interpretation. I think this is the one that's going to have to be be the correct one, because not only are these sources fainter as if they're being absorbed, but the nature of the absorption is such that the X-rays are absorbed by hydrogen, which would be in the plane of the galaxy, and the soft X-rays would be absorbed more than the hard, so these would be harder. And now I have a plot which I'm going to show you, in which you can see that as they get absorbed, they get as they get harder. Now, does that make sense? And can I go back to this observation again? And you can see that if the galaxy is pointed this way towards you, that you're seeing up in here, unobscured by this disk, which comes out, and down here it's obscured because you see it's reddened and absorbed. So that has two consequences. First of all, it means that the disk of hydrogen goes outside the optical disk. And this is known from spiral galaxies. You see the optical disk and the rotating curves in the interior. Exterior to that, there is a hydrogen disk, not marked by star. But it's unusual that it would extend so far out, because it has to extend out this, and that would be very unusual. So the job now is to get hydrogen measures of this, probably from Australia, and to check on that. The other thing, which is so interesting now, is that it means that if these bright ones are quasars, that these probably are quasars also. I mean, what else would they be? They're point sources, they're X-ray sources, and if they could be optically identified, they're quite faint, they would undoubtedly turn out to be quasars. So what we're presented with is a very active galaxy which has a bunch of quasars around it, just a cloud of quasars. And this is be the most populous galaxy with quasars. It would be a final proof of this association of quasars with galaxies. Now, I also have the survey, the X-ray survey observations, which are over a larger area. And you can see this is the galaxy that I'm talking about. And these are three of the quasars. Now you see this quasar is very high. It's normal state. And going down in this other direction, we have more X-ray sources, including a quasar candidate here. So over the large portion of the sky, apparently these quasars are aligned, they're concentrated toward the center, they're absorbed by the hydrogen and dust and gas in the galaxy. And this is probably the best example of association of quasars and galaxies. Now, there's one thing that I do want to say, which is a little technical, but I think it's very exciting. And that is, I had high resolution X-ray observations of it. And you can see that now this quasar is very bright. It's a normal state. The other bright one over here is now off the field because this is a smaller area in the field. You see there's a region in here which is filled in with some apparently X-ray material which goes up and toward these stars. But the PSPC, the broadband observations, just didn't show anything in there. And so I suspected something, that there might be an ultraviolet leak in the X-ray filter. So I, just before I left, I looked at the hardest X-rays, and there's nothing in here, but in the lower channels, in this particular observation, there's lots and lots of stuff. And you see, here are the two quasars. They're fairly connected by material which now looks as though it's ultraviolet radiation between 1500 and 1700 angstrom. And what this means needs to be investigated, because it might be redshift 11 alpha, it might be some sort of hot gas. I don't know what it is, but it's very interesting physically to see what it is. And it's very interesting physically to see what it is, and of course it's further confirmation of the association of these quasars. Well, if the quasars are associated with the galaxies. Then comes this question of what is the redshift due to? And I might go a little bit into the theory at the end, but the point I want to make now is that we know something about this redshift, this non-velocity redshift, from looking at the nearest galaxies to us. And that means our local group and the next nearest group out, M81. And I want to show you some of the latest results on this, because it bears directly on the question of what is this excess or this intrinsic redshift due to. And the next slide shows, sort of introduces this subject. Can we have the next slide, please? That's a picture of M81 in true color, in the sense that you see the mass of old stars in the center here, and then you see the bright young blue stars in the spiral arms. This is an SB spiral galaxy. The SBs, I will claim, are the central galaxy, the dominant galaxy, the parent galaxy in groups of galaxies. And the other galaxies in a group are younger and smaller. They're called companion galaxies. The next slide shows an example of this, which is M33 in our own local group. And this maybe looks something like our own galaxy, which is a companion to M31, the central dominant galaxy in our own group. And you'll see that the old star central portion is much reduced, and the young star portion is much accentuated. So the one thing you can say for sure is that these companion galaxies, these kinds of spirals, have a higher percentage of younger stars. And we can make technical arguments about whether that means they're younger or not, but certainly they have higher percentage of younger stars. Now, so what about the redshift properties of these galaxies we know the most about? And these are not quasars, they're not exotic objects, they're really our nearest neighboring galaxies. And here's a plot which shows what we're dealing with. And this is our local group. M31 is the central dominant galaxy, and these other galaxies should be orbiting around it. NGC 20532, our Milky Way system, this is us, the small Magellanic Cloud, the large Magellanic Cloud, and so forth. And now this is a new system which has just been, not discovered, but it's been known for a long time, but it was not known to be a member of the local group until they got a good measure of the reddening and obscuration front of it, and they could correct it, could find the distance, and they found, in fact, it was a member of the local group. The amazing thing is that every one of these local group companions has a higher redshift than the central galaxy. Now, if these galaxies were in orbit around the central galaxy, you should see as many coming towards you as going away from you. If these were velocities, you should see as many plus velocities as minus velocities. And in fact, you don't. You see them all plus, and this new one at plus 289 kilometers per second. Now, okay, this is our local group. What can we say about the next nearest group to us? It's the M81 group. That's the Whirlpool Nebula, the first color slide I showed. And here's M81, and here are the companions to M81, including M82 now, which is a very explosive galaxy just to the north of M81, which is actually linked to M81 by our hydrogen bridge. So we know that's in the group, we know it's part of it, and yet it's got an excess redshift of almost 300 kilometers per second. So all these companion galaxies also have excess redshifts. And the chances of this happening by accident is one there's 22 galaxies all here, and the chance of these 22 galaxies all having plus redshifts, when the chance of being any one of them is only 50-50, is about one chance in 4 million. So I think that there's only one chance in 4 million of this being an accident. So we have to take it very seriously. And the question is, does this tell us anything about what causes the excess redshift? And this excess redshift, I would claim, is the same excess redshift that's operating in the quasar. Well, you look at these galaxies and you say, this is made up of stars and dust and gas. These are made up of stars and dust and gas. These, they're all galaxies made up of stars and dust and gas, like this. What is the one difference between these dominant galaxies and the companions? And you have to say it's the amount of old stars. These have the biggest amount of old stars. And you can see in the spectrum, these have younger stars. I would say, in fact, that they're younger galaxies. This immediately correlates to the quasars, because they also have to be young. And the way they have to be young is you realize that these are point energy sources of tremendous energy. They're radiating very hard. The pressure, the radiation pressure inside, is tending to blow them apart. The energy can't last this long. They're burning energy at too great a rate. So therefore, they have to be young from those arguments. These don't have to be young from that argument. They're just young from the fact that they're close enough by so we can study the individual stars in them. As a matter of fact, if you study individual stars in them, you can see that the individual stars have excess redshifts too. Seem to have lost transparency, so I won't show that. But I can just say to you that the individual stars in these galaxies also have excess redshift. For example, large nebulae cloud, small cloud, the supergiants are almost all redshifted with respect to the center of the galaxy. Well, so this is true of the nearest galaxies to it in the local group. Is it true of the big clusters? And it seems it's true of the big clusters also, because here's the Virgo cluster at the center of our local supercluster. And here are all of the galaxies plotted in this region of the sky, and plotted against the redshift, 1,000 kilometers per second, 2,000. And you see, the mean redshift of the Virgo cluster is about in here. And these smaller galaxies in the Virgo cluster are companion galaxies, just like the companions I was just talking about. And they spring out to 2,000 and above, almost 3,000 kilometers per second. So even though they're a member of the Virgo cluster, the companion galaxies, again, are systematically redshifted. Now, I can show that in another plot. Where here's the mean redshift, and you can see the excess redshift in these companions going out and out. Now this has some bearing on this local, this latest. there's this. The slide showing the excess redshifts of the individual supergiant stars in the small nebulae cloud, the large nebulae cloud. You see every one of these is redshifted with respect to the galaxy it's in. Let's see. I wanted to make a remark about the latest. Well, maybe that'll come up in the question period about the latest distance to the Virgo cluster, which you maybe read about in the newspapers or Nature magazine or things like that, where they have a new Hubble constant. And there's difficulty because this Hubble constant implies an age of the universe which is less than the age of the oldest stars, which is a direct contradiction. And I can make some remarks about that in a question period. But let me say about this question of the excess redshifts of the companion galaxies. This paper was published in July, and as you might imagine, it immediately incurred a lot of criticism from the establishment. And they were saying, writing papers and complaints and saying, well, maybe the statistics are wrong, and maybe you shouldn't figure the statistics the way I figured them and so forth. And trying to excuse this this result. And as fate would have it, just 2 months later, after this paper of mine had appeared and this controversy was going on, I just happened to look at a professional journal called Astronomy and Astrophysics, the European Astronomy Journal, and my eye was caught by an article. This was just a random event, and because my name was in the title, it said something about ARC 105, and so I looked at the article to see what it was, and I recognized the galaxy right away because it was called ARC 105 because it was in the atlas of computer galaxies, and I looked at it. And I looked at it, and I started realizing what the article was saying, and I realized that this article was direct confirmation of this result, which I was just showing you about the excess redshift of companion galaxies. Now, I'm going to show you a picture of this object, which is called ARC 105, and this is not my picture, this was a picture in the article. And it's an interesting little history about this object. Actually, you see, in the 1950s, when the sky survey was done at Palomar, and people were able to look at a complete photographic record of the whole sky, there was an Armenian astronomer called Amritsumian, Victor Amritsumian, and nobody had very much heard of Victor Amritsumian. He was kind of a hero in Armenia. But the astronomical world hadn't heard much of him. And he had access to no telescopes, but he just had a copy of this new photographic atlas that had come out from the Palomar Observatory. And he studied it. He really looked at those galaxies in that atlas, and he thought about what he saw. And one of the galaxies he saw was this galaxy. And I have a black and white photograph of it, and he saw it in black and white. But he saw this E galaxy here, and he saw it ejecting this galaxy here, the straight filament, and this tremendous ejection filament coming out, ending on that galaxy, and there's some more stuff coming up here. And these and other galaxies like it led him to the conclusion that galaxies ejected new galaxies, that this is the way new galaxies were born. And Amritsumian announced this in 1957 at the Solvay conference in Belgium, and again in 1960, I think, in the IAU meeting in California. And people at that point paid some attention to it. Independently, I had been making this atlas of peculiar galaxies with much better photographs with a 200-inch, and this was number 105 of my atlas, and I didn't know about Amritsumian's work at the time, and I also concluded that this galaxy was ejecting, and that this is the way new galaxies were born. So the two of us agreed on this, and we published this. Now, that's 1957. This is 1994, 37 years later. This paper appears in Astronomy and Astrophysics, and they don't mention anything about ejection. They say, well, this is an example of collision and merger, because collision and merger is a great fad these days. And whenever anybody sees two galaxies anywhere near each other, they say, they're merging, or they're colliding with each other. And they forget all this evidence about the radio ejections coming out and so forth. So that, in fact, I even saw in one paper the following remark: if you see two galaxies next to each other, they're in the process of merging. If you only see one galaxy, it means it's already merged. This is the kind of approach we have here. So I was sort of bemused by this interpretation, a little provoked by it, and felt that, in fact, we've gone backwards in these 37 years. But that isn't the electrifying thing about this system. What is really electrifying is that this person who published this paper had measured the redshifts of these companion galaxies. This one, and 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 this one. All together, they measured about a dozen galaxies, maybe less. And the nine galaxies that were in the redshift range of this, all nine companions were higher redshift than this central galaxy. And now you see here, there was no argument about which was the dominant galaxy. Everybody said this was a massive elliptical. And they said it was central in the cluster, so that, and that these were the companion galaxies. And here were the companion galaxies, all nine of them appeared coming out plus redshift. And this is a confirmation at a level of about 4 × 10⁻³, chance of being accidental, 4 chances in 1,000 of being accidental. Or if you took the ninth galaxy, which was also a little higher redshifted, 2 chances in 1,000. Here I'll show you the plot. And you see, it looks just like these plots that we were looking at for the local group and the M81 group and the Virgo cluster for that matter. And here's the dominant galaxy, and here are the companions all at higher redshift. Well, what does it mean? It means that some agency, some mechanism that's working in these companion galaxies, which is not philosophy, but which gives it a redshift. And empirically, I would argue that that's the age. The younger the galaxy is, the higher the redshift. And there is some suggestion as to why this might be so, which I may go into in the last 2 minutes. But I want to show you now in the slides another example of ejection and why I think Albert Zumion was right when he said, galaxy, to him, next slide, please. Why galaxies were born from other galaxies. Now this was originally classified as a quasar. It's a radio source called 3C120, and on the low resolution plates, it looked just like a star, so compact. These are very high resolution plates that I got at Palomar Cathedral, I think, and superposed and put into true color. So you can see this is a very active galaxy with jets coming out this way, and that very peculiar galaxy up in there. So it's a very young galaxy. It's got a very young spectrum. The stars in there are young. It's extremely active. It's a radio source. And the next slide shows what the radio shows. Here is the central blue object, which you just saw. And here are these jets coming out. You can see the radio jet here, much further out. And these big radio lobes on the other side. And this galaxy, companion galaxy up here, at plus 5,000 kilometers per second, which is very, very peculiar, and which must also belong. Now, this is like the X-ray sources that I was showing earlier today. And maybe I'll just show one or two now to emphasize the similarity. There's a quasar. This is an X-ray observation. A quasar, a galaxy with a jet, and the nucleus of the galaxy pointing toward the quasar. You also see these alignments. I'll show this one. Here's another active galaxy quasar pair. Here's the active galaxy, here's the quasar, this is the one you just saw. And here's these strings of X-ray sources. Apparently, I would say, being ejected, that's a quasar. A lot of these in here are quasar candidates. I think we must be seeing the same phenomenon. And this phenomenon you see in all scales in the universe. You see it in art, in T-Tauri stars, our Arabian objects, stars just forming in our own galaxy, rejecting things in opposite directions. You see it in galaxies on all scales. You see it in the X-rays. And it always involves this different kinds of redshifts. And the only uniform principle I can see is that they are younger material, material which is created in the center of the galaxies and shot out. Now, I showed the Burma cluster earlier today, and maybe I ought to refresh that. This was, well, no, it's not published. It was presented in the IAU, but it shows the Virgo cluster in X-rays. And this is, as I said, the center of our local supercluster. Center of our local supercluster. And you can see the connection all the way down from the active galaxies in the center of our cluster down to this, this most famous quasar 3673, which again, a connection of a young high redshift object into a group of older objects. And I show now some of the most highest energy observations ever made in the new gamma ray observatory. And now these are gamma rays, which are, you see the X-rays have energies from a tenth of a keV up to 2 keV. These gamma rays, I'll show you now, have energies up to from 100 to 1,000 to 10,000 MeVs, huge energies. And this is the area which I just showed you, the bottom of the Virgo cluster. This is 3C279. And it was not announced in the this is a Sky Telescope picture, but right here is 3C273. So apparently, the Virgo cluster is extended downward in very, very high energy radiation. And you can see here now, this gamma radiation, which is indicated by the big isotopes here. The reason the isotopes are so big because the gamma ray telescope has low resolution. And so it only can resolve about this much. But the important point is that as you go down the Virgo cluster, you have the optical radiation, you have the X radiation, it's becoming higher and higher energy, and finally you get down into the gamma radiation, which is extremely high energy. And the question is now, where does this high energy radiation come from? And I would guess that the only possibility would be matter creation. And I think that this, even more than the question of the redshifts, is the real frontier exciting area in astronomy now. If you don't have the Big Bang, and I think that these observations certainly rule out the Big Bang, then you have to say, you have continuous episodic creation. You don't create everything out of nothing 15 billion years ago as in the Big Bang. You're creating material all along. And the question is, what would be the signature of that? How would you know if that material is being created? How would you know if you could see matter being created? And the answer is, I think, that you would see this this new matter annihilating itself, say, new positrons and electrons annihilating, giving gamma rays, or maybe the breakup of particles giving pions, which give a gamma rays, these huge energy things. And it's very short-lived. And this would be the observational signature of new matter, and that you would be seeing in this case the creation of new matter, as you're seeing in these galaxies here. Now, the only thing I want to to say now, to conclude this, for the sort of tie it together, is that you have to ask yourself the question of in what form would this new matter be created? Are you going to, and first of all, I should explain the word creation. Because the universe is defined as everything that we can see or could see, you're not going to create new universes or create new matter that wasn't already in the universe. You would have to, say, recycle it, or it would be materialized from a more diffuse state. And if you were looking at a point in space-time and suddenly new matter came up, you would say, well, okay, it materialized from some other place in the universe. So you might call it an emergence of new matter. And the question is whether this new matter arrives with the masses, the protons, and the neutrons, the same masses that we know of in our terrestrial laboratories. And as I explained earlier today, there is a solution of the general relativistic equations, which Nonacron I considers more general, which would say that this matter arrives in a zero mass state. In other words, the electrons that are newly created, the protons that are newly created, are created with a very low mass, and as time goes on, they grow. Now, if that's true, then you can get your annihilation radiation, you can get this tremendous radiation that we're observing now, and at the same time, you would have the high redshifts, which are the signature of the new matter, the young matter, the quasars, and the young galaxies. So this would be, I mean, I'm suggesting this as a tying together of all the observations that you see here. This next slide, I just will show you the final sort of empirical coup de grace on this. You see this active galaxy 3C120 is surrounded by quasars, these black dots, the quasars. This has been published for a number of years, but ignored. It's another indication that, in fact, these high redshift quasars are associated with this recently created material from this galaxy. So this would be a suggestion on how the thing might work. As you know, the theories are never proven. It's just theory you can disprove. And the only way you make progress is disproving theories. And I think that what we've done here, or what we can do here with these observations, if your judgment is that way, that we've disproved the Big Bang, we've disproved instantaneous creation, and we now are dealing with creation, ongoing creation of matter in the universe, and whether or not this can be used to explain the redshift phenomenon, that remains to be seen, but I think it would be real progress to say that we have, that this data does disprove the Big Bang, and that we're left with this fascinating new evidence on the emergence of new matter into the universe, which is going to grow into our galaxies, galaxies like our own, and give rise to the life that we know. So I guess I would stop there and invite questions. Thank you.
I have an article here from the London Sunday Telegraph, and it says, Hoyle, creation theory turns black holes inside out. I guess you know about this, eh? Apparently, Hoyle is saying that the matter is created inside the galaxies and thrown out, sort of what you're saying, as opposed to the current idea of the Big Bang.
So yes.
He's sort of in your camp, or
that's,
maybe you want
that's
to talk.
That's definitely true. And I might elucidate that a little bit more. And Hoyle and some of the other people who thought about this have felt that this creation out of nothing, which the Big Bang represents, I mean, 15 billion years ago, there was nothing, and suddenly something was created, that's not very scientific. And so what they're trying to do is to say, what actually causes the creation of new matter? And they say, all right, let's take a concentration of matter, like a black hole or a massive object, like perhaps in the centers of these galaxies, and that deforms the metric of space there. And it produces a kink in the creation tensor, then reaches a critical point, and new matter starts pouring out. And that's the way we produce new mass. Now, I have written together with Hoyle some criticisms of the Big Bang, and we're agreed on that. The point where we're still contending is whether Hoyle wants to produce this new matter with its present mass, and then we can't explain the redshift. He admits that. But if we produce the new matter with low mass, then we can explain the redshift. So that's the thing that we're discussing now.
I don't quite understand this point about the redshift and the low mass, because I would have thought that if you create your electrons with low mass, you'd in fact produce a blue shift.
It goes the following way. When the electron makes the jump in its orbit to emit the photon, the energy of that photon which it emits is a function of the mass of the electron. So if the mass of the electron is low, then the energy is low and the photon is redshifted. And then as time goes on, the mass of the electron grows, the energy of that transition is higher and it becomes blue shifted. So it starts out very redshifted. As time goes on, it becomes more and more blue shifted.
Mm-hmm. Over what period of time does this low mass electron assume normal, quote, normal mass?
Yeah, that's a good question. Because the actual solution of the Einstein equations, which Donathan made, has the mass varying as t squared. The mass varies as the time squared. And if you put in for the time, the age of the old stars in our galaxy, so that's the only parameter you put in, you get out of it the exact Hubble relationship. You get exact Hubble relationship. And in fact, you get h naught equals 50. And what that means is that this electron that we're considering is exchanging gravitons with the rest of the universe, but the universe that it sees is getting bigger and bigger. And so it's exchanging gravitons with more and more in the universe, and so its mass is growing. Its mass is growing just the right amount, so that as you look at more and more distant galaxies, you're seeing them earlier in their lifetime when their mass of electrons were lower and their redshifts were higher. So what it means is in a non-expanding universe, in a static universe of indefinite size, indefinite age, you get an exact redshift distance relationship. Except for the objects which are younger, which are born younger, and then they have a high redshift. Yes?
Wouldn't this phenomenon you're describing blur all spectral line measurements made in the laboratory on Earth? I mean, just the slight dispersion in ages of the atoms being used at any one time should cause, should make it impossible with extremely sharp lines that we actually see in the lab.
Well, no, the point is that any if a galaxy, say, is born at a certain epoch, all of the atoms in there will have the same masses and so forth, and you'll get all the same redshift and so forth. If something is born a little bit later, i.e. it's younger, then its lines will have the same width, that's the chemistry, but they'll be shifted to the red.
So you're saying the galaxy is born essentially instantly. It can't be born over a period of many, many years, because then the lines would be broadened within the matter of that galaxy.
No, I don't think the galaxies are born instantly. I think there is a spread in the age of the galaxies, and I think that's what explains the fact that the supergiant stars in the Magellanic Clouds are systematically redshifted. And the picture I think I would recommend is that you have a cloud of pre-stellar material, which is going to form into a star. Okay, that cloud, the material in that cloud was born at a certain time, forms into a star. A star is a certain epoch, has a certain redshift. There's another cloud, which is born later, which is younger. It forms into a star. It has its spectrum and so forth. But because its epoch is younger, the lines are redshift.
but supposedly our solar system is made up of both the primordial matter, but also that from supernova explosions, the elements. These presumably would have a spread of time, a spread of ages.
Well, there's something that's a little difficult to keep straight here. And that is that there's an evolutionary time. I mean, see, the star is born, it goes through its evolutionary cycle, it goes into the white dwarf stage, it maybe explodes into a supernova. That's all evolutionary age, but the matter which constitutes that is all of the same epoch, it's all the same age, and I think that's true of most of our galaxy and certainly of our local neighborhood. But a star that's born out of younger matter goes through that whole evolutionary cycle, but its matter is consistently redshifted. You see, in the Magellanic Clouds, for example, if you have matter born at one epoch and another, the older epoch, which would be the bluer redshift, that goes through its evolutionary cycle, and those supergiants burn away, leaving only the most recent the matter most recently created, and they have the high redshift, and that's why the supergiants in the Magellanic Cloud have a high redshift. It's the point of creation of the matter. Yeah, it's not the evolutionary. Yeah.
So as this matter acquires more mass or gets heavier, its gravitational field is going to get stronger. Is that correct?
Yes.
So what, when it's first brought into existence through this mechanism, what fraction of what we consider to be normal mass would it have? 1%? 2%? Half?
Well, I think in the very beginning, it starts off from zero, essentially.
I'm wondering how you could have a star form if it might not have sufficient gravity to stay together as a star.
Oh,
if the mass not.
Yeah, it's not going to form at that. It's not going to form until it gets enough gravity to start to pull it together on the conventional way when stars form. Yeah, no. It will acquire mass rather rapidly at first, and then go into the normal phase. I might just make another comment, and that is that it's always been a holy quest to unify or to understand the connection between classical mechanics and quantum mechanics. And if you go through this m equals zero phase, then you're at the natural transition point between quantum and classical mechanics. So I think that's an interesting opportunity for physics now. That's a little off your point, I guess. Yeah.
Would you not see some tendency that the further quasar is away from its parent galaxy, the less redshift? Would have seems to me to see an evolutionary trend going away from the parent galaxy.
Yeah, and Narokar has actually worked out a model for that, where the quasar is ejected and then goes out and it ages. And acquire certain redshifts. But I don't think we know enough about the distribution of the redshifts of quasars around these galaxies to say whether that's true or not. And also the fact that it depends a lot on how forcefully the particular quasar has been ejected, whether it's been ejected to a large distance or a short distance. I can say that the quasars of redshift 1 apparently be the most luminous, and the quasars of redshift 2 and 3 are, on these observations, very low luminosity. I didn't say this, but in this NGC galaxy, NGC 1097, there is a very faint quasar there as a redshift 3, and that's what you'd about expect, because the luminosity is low. The mass is low, the luminosity is low, the redshift is high. You might find something this eventually, but I don't think we have enough data.
Presumably the decrease then in luminosity after you said decrease to 1 would be in the star formation? Or I know you talk about the luminosity increasing to 1 and then dropping off again after you.
Well, that's a function. Yeah, that's right. probably the increase in luminosity as it ages, say from redshift 3 to redshift 1, is due to the fact that the mass is growing and there's more energetic reaction. And then it begins to start form and disperse, and then it doesn't drop very much. I think it levels off. Yeah, what is that?
Yes, there was a synergy mentioned earlier about black holes and matter that falls into a black hole past the event horizon. I've generally heard that we treat it in terms of space falling in faster than speed of light rather than matter falling in faster than speed of light. I'm wondering, when we say that matter is being generated on quasars, are we, is this synonymous to generating space as well?
Generating what?
Space, like I'm a total amateur when it comes to that, but let me just try to rephrase this again. Past the event horizon of a black hole, what I've heard is space falls towards the black hole, and that's permitted. Matter cannot fall, precedence be applied towards the black hole. So if a black hole drags space and matter into itself, would matter generated by quasar be equivalent to the reverse process, basically generating space as well, like in the inflationary model of the universe where we...
Yes, I think that it's a very good suggestion. First of all, Hoyle pointed out that a white hole is just a time reversal of a black hole. Observationally, I would say that all the evidence shows things flowing out, not flowing in. So I don't see any observational evidence for a black hole, and I believe Marmé's arguments, and I think that the black holes are not realizing. So observationally, empirically, I see the outflow, and it is a time reversal. And I think it is like in the inflationary universe. And the point, that's a very good point, because the inflationary aspect of the Big Bang was raised in order to save the Big Bang from some contradictions, from the internal contradictions. But what they didn't realize at the time when they introduced this inflationary model was that was just the old C term, Hoyle's C term for creation of matter. So that was what Hoyle introduced for the steady state theory, actually, to inject matter into the universe. And I think it is the reverse. I think often scientists start out by getting things backwards. They start out. I don't know. I hope they finish up. Yes.
You had some comments about the recent Virgo cluster observations.
Oh yeah. That's been much in the news now, and they've gotten a determination of the Virgo cluster distance at 15 megaparsecs, and we're looking at that slide before. And this is a point of much contention. Well, I'm going to have to describe this. Yeah. Okay, I'm going to have to describe this. Okay. There's been this contest between the people who say the Hubble's the constant of expansion is 50 kilometers per second per megaparsec, and those who say it's near 100. And what they've done is they say the crucial thing is the distance to the Virgo cluster. And they take the redshift, the mean redshift for the Virgo cluster at about 1,000 kilometers per second, and they say, well, if the distance to the Virgo cluster is about 21 megaparsecs, which is what Sandage uses, then the Hubble constant is 50. And if the distance to the Virgo cluster is about 15 megaparsecs, then the Hubble constant is around 87. Now, the trouble is, of course, all right, so there's been a big battle. Recently, with Space Telescope, they have measured Cepheids in two spirals,
in the Virgo cluster, and they get both of them, they agree on 87, or very close to 87, a little small error. So, okay, the people with the high Hubble constant say, wow, we won, that's great. But they're in big trouble because if the Hubble constant is 87, then the age of the universe is only one half the age of the oldest stars, which is a paradox. I mean, how can you have the stars older than the universe? Now, the only way they can get out of that is to put in a cosmological constant, which is what Einstein called the fudge factor. He abandoned it, didn't like it. But it's really what it is, it's an adjustable parameter, which is now put in to save this discordancy. Now, that's the way it stands from the conventional standpoint. From my standpoint, what I say is, and I can't find the slide to show it to you, but if you look at the Virgo cluster and look at the distributions of the redshifts in the Virgo cluster, you see that the elliptical galaxies in the Virgo cluster have about 800 kilometers per second redshift. The spirals have a mean of 1,000 kilometers per second. But the SAs and the SBs, there's practically none in the Virgo cluster. The galaxies we can really trust, the galaxies like the center of our local group, they have redshifts that are either zero or negative, I mean catastrophic. So what it amounts to, and you can show this on a plot, you can choose any redshift you like for the Virgo cluster. So okay, the distance is 15 megaparsecs, but H0 equals 50, I believe, because that's the inverse of the solution we get for the static universe. And it just tells you something about the age, the mean age of the Virgo cluster. So, as I said, I guess at dinner tonight, if I talk to Sandage and I say, Alan, I don't care what other people say, I believe H0 equals 50, but I don't believe the universe is expanding. You see, it depends on what redshift you take for the Virgo cluster. And that's the part that they've overlooked. Everybody's just said, oh, we know the Virgo cluster is 1,000 pounds per second. And they haven't really looked at that point. That's a crucial point. It's the redshifts that come in. Always the redshifts that cause the trouble. And it causes trouble because people make easy assumptions about it. let me see, back first here.
You made a comment before about the black holes. That was sort of a little quick throwaway comment about not seeing much evidence of that. I'm sorry, I didn't understand that.
Well, all I'm saying is that all this photographic evidence, all this observational evidence, all the spectroscopic evidence I see is evidence of material outflow. Black holes, you would expect material inflow. And I'm just saying that I only see evidence for white holes, out stuff going out. That's an empirical observational problem.
Yes, you've shown us some good examples of active galaxies with quasars showing the shifts that you're showing us. But I'm wondering, has there been a more extensive survey, an unbiased one, of all active galaxies or a random sampling of active galaxies and looking at the quasars around them? And what kind of results come out of that type of survey, if there has been one?
Well, there's two systematic surveys that have been done. One systematic survey that I did that took something like 3 or 4 years, which was to look at a pre-selected sample of companion galaxies. And there I found that the quasars were more dense near these companion galaxies by a factor of 20. It was a 16 sigma signal. So I consider that a very strong statistical proof. The establishment astronomers disagreed with that very much. The other thing is, you say about active galaxies. Well, there's been no systematic survey of active galaxies, but I can tell you the following. That is, we know what the most active galaxies are. I've shown you a lot of them. And every one of those most active galaxies we've looked at has lots of quasars in
them. I guess I'm asking, are there any counterexamples to what you've shown us?
You mean an active galaxy without quasars in it?
Or active galaxies with quasars not showing the redshift phenomenon that you're describing?
Well, no, see, the quasars will always have high redshift compared to the active galaxies because the active galaxy has to be close enough for you to see it pretty well, so it's going to have a low redshift. So if you see quasars around a low redshift galaxy or active galaxy, you've got But I don't know of a single active galaxy that doesn't have these things in its environment. I mean, like this one I showed in the colored picture. I mean, and you see, the people who reported these redshifts didn't mention the fact that all these companions were higher redshift. And they knew, I mean, they must have known that this was an absolutely crucial point in the whole debate, you see, and they didn't even mention it. I can imagine they didn't mention Albert Sumion, or they didn't mention me, or the ejection, or okay, they can talk about collision and merger if they want. This point about the systematic redshift, that really should have been mentioned. Yep. Oh yeah, back here is a new one.
Yeah. Okay, I'll just wonder, when you create matter, don't you make a lot of order?
Make a what?
Order, like, you know.
Make order.
Yeah. When you create use entropy.
Well, entropy, yeah, that's a nice question. You have to, you're creating at zero entropy, a lot of information. And that's an argument I had with Roger Penrose, actually. He argues that in order to create a universe, you have to have so much information that you can only do it once, or some argument like that. But I think what you're getting at, I think, is a very important point, which is that you're creating this matter with zero mass, but it has lots and lots of information. It has enough information to make a whole galaxy, because I think it evolves into a whole galaxy. And so you can't create an isolated electron or positron. You have to create an ensemble of these things. And that's why I think you only create in the presence of big masses, because then you influence a region of space which is large enough to introduce a diffuse pieces from diffuse mass energy from another place in a large enough quantity to have enough information in it to produce a quasar which then evolves into a galaxy, if that's what you mean.
Yeah, what I was asking, if things tend to go towards randomness, shouldn't the cycle of creation line itself out?
Do what?
You're saying, if things tend to go towards chaos, towards randomness, shouldn't this cycle of creation of matter just burn out?
Oh, well, yeah, after you've created galaxy, it's going to run down, run down the thermodynamic hill. But as if you're asking about in a region of space, will the creation run down? I would think so, probably. All the creation seems to be episodic. Now, whether our local supercluster is going to continue to fill up and get more and more dense, or whether it's going to quit, or it's going to take up in another place, that's questions for the future. I mean,
you always have less energy than you start with, so eventually.
Probably not on a universal scale, if you believe in the conservation of mass energy. And you say if mass energy pops up here, it's subtracted from someplace else.
But eventually you run out of your ability to do useful work. It's all kind of news.
Yeah, unless you can recycle it. But of course, don't forget that this non-expanding universe that I'm talking about is an indefinite large extent. I mean, the point is we may, in all our pride and arrogance, think we're seeing a lot of the universe, but in fact, it may be just an infinitesimal part of the universe that exists.
So the cycle can't perpetuate itself forever, but it's creation.
It depends on whether it recycles, whether it's reversible, or whether it recycles, and how much of a reservoir it's drawing on, how big the universe is.
But can you recycle 100%?
What?
Can you recycle 100% of the energy you have?
I don't know. If you have enough time, I suppose you can do anything. You see, there's no time limit on this either.
But is it reasonable that you could?
Huh?
Is it reasonable that you could recycle all the energy you have?
Yeah, give it enough time, sure. I don't think that the proton is going to last forever. I mean, they're talking about proton decay.
Is there a high probability that it would?
Yeah. Yeah,
then the other thing you have to realize is that I don't think you should necessarily assume that everything has always got to be the way it is now. And we may be going through changes which we can hardly imagine.
But why should the laws of physics out there where the quasars be different from the Earth?
You should ask the question the other way. Why should the laws of physics out there be the same as they are in our time in the world? Yeah?
Is the cosmic background radiation a fact, and if it is not a signature of the Big Bang, what might it be? Where does it fit in your view of things?
Okay. On the Big Bang, I think the cosmic background radiation is very, very difficult to explain, because you have to say that it comes from the last surface that you see out, or the first surface, the decoupling surface. And at that surface, you have to have a smoothness to 1 part in 10 to the 5th, and you should see the footprints of the galaxies, the primordial galaxies, and you don't. And so there's all sorts of gyrations about cold matter and biased cold matter and so forth and so on. And I think it's just very, very difficult. On a non-expanding universe, it's just as simple as it can be, because you're just seeing the temperature of the intergalactic medium.
In the Virgo cluster, is there an equivalently large display on the opposite end of it? Like, and most of them you're seeing is kind of a bilateral.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. No. No, there isn't. Not well. No, I shouldn't say that. The Virgo cluster does continue out up the north. The X-rays seem to be petering out here. But this is what I consider to be the center of the Virgo cluster, M49. This is the oldest galaxy. It's the brightest galaxy in the Virgo cluster, and it's the lowest redshift of the big ellipticals. So I think that's the center, M49. And this is almost symmetrical. Now, what this higher energy extension is, I don't know. It may be pointing somewhat toward us, or it may be a recent event. It may be counterbalanced on the other side by something later.
In one of the diagrams you showed us, there was return to be a larger ejection one way than the other. Mm-hmm. Are those all in any way aligned? Is it, could it be like representative of a circle or anything like that?
No. I don't know what you mean by a circle, but.
If it was a spiral, where are these at all aligned with that spiral? Or are they just pointing in random directions, like at the larger end, pointing any which way?
Well, I think for every ejection, there's a counter-ejection. That seems to be an empirical principle. But as for the direction of the ejection and the counter-ejection, I don't know. That seems to be a mystery to me, because if you take this, for example, and you say, okay, say this is an ejection and a counter-ejection along the minor axis, which is what you'd expect, then what is this ejection along the major axis? That doesn't make any sense. And you see this pattern again and again. You see it to some extent in NGC 1097, and you see it in the other four X-ray observations which I didn't show tonight. They seem to be in this direction, and it almost made me think that maybe ejection isn't the total story. Maybe, for example, it's intersecting strings, white lines, and where they intersect, you have a creation node, and maybe then that generates the pressure in there, and the ejections then are forced down along the strings. That's just a suggestion. I mean, just to indicate that maybe we don't have to go do everything with ejection. Maybe even ejection isn't the primary thing.
Yes? That is dark matter. Could this not be newly born matter that you're talking about? This great amount of this dark matter, could this not be this nascent matter?
Well, you have to understand how this dark matter came about. And my viewpoint on the dark matter is that, for instance, in a cluster of galaxies, they measured the redshifts, and they assumed the redshifts were velocities. And to have this much velocity, they had to have a lot more matter in that cluster than they saw in luminous galaxies. So that's where the dark matter came from. But if a lot of the redshifts in that cluster
are not philosophies, then the need for the dark matter disappears. So I think that for me, the dark matter was just something that was invented to explain the discrepancy in the standard picture. And you know, they've looked for it high and low, whips, machos, under the bed, and behind the closet, and they haven't found it. And they spent a lot of money looking for it, too. Yes.
One thing, one scale, going back to the problem of the mass varying, it seems to me that if you have very low mass nucleons, you will have no nuclei.
Well, this thing's relative, you know. I mean, it's always all the mass varies in ratio.
It doesn't scale out of the equations like it does for atom.
At a certain point, I do believe you're going to lose normal chemistry.
I'm thinking more of the this is presumably a testable prediction that you have the nuclei you'll see in your ejected quasars will be a very different nuclear ratio than you can see in normal galaxies.
The atomic nuclei?
Yes.
Would you mean would it, the matter would have a different chemical composition?
Yes.
I hadn't thought about that. There is a problem with the quasars from the standard point of view, and that is a lot of these high-redshift quasars now, they have determined, are very metal-rich. And the problem from the standard theory is that they don't have time to get that enriched. So there's, so I do know that. And I hadn't thought about how the low mass would predict. I don't think so, because according to Hoyle, the nucleosynthesis, well, but he doesn't use low mass, that's right.
Well, the neutron will be unstable.
Pardon?
The neutron will be unstable.
With low mass?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Would it be bad to have the neutron unstable?
It's then presumably very difficult to synthesize anything heavier. If you have no A equals 2.
Yeah, that may be so, although then the question is, at what point does the synthesis take place in the mass scale? And that I don't know. Yeah, that's something to look into. Yeah. I will try to remember and ask my nucleosynthesis experts that. Yeah, that's an interesting point. Yeah?
It seems to me as a layman that to start a universe off with a big bang, philosophically it's kind of stupid. I mean, I can't imagine, you know, starting a universe with a bang. I mean, it seems kind of bizarre philosophically. I'm just wondering why this particular theory of the creation of the universe is so tenacious. Why do people, and say, when you get observations that are discordant, or when you have to go through all kinds of gyrations to defend it, why is this theory so attractive to most astronomers? Why do they not really want to think about anything else or another option?
Yeah, it is rather difficult being working on a farm for a while. You know, you have to ask the question, if you have a cosmic egg, where was the cosmic chicken that laid the cosmic egg? How do you produce something out of nothing? Well, I guess there's two answers. First of all, inertia. I mean, people who talk something and believe something, they find it hard to change. I find it hard to just true of myself. And secondly, I think that the conventional people will tell you, well, there's just nothing better around. I've had one of the best physicists in the world say, okay, there's nothing wrong with the whole monocar theory, but we don't need it because our present theory explains everything. But of course, it doesn't explain these observations. On the other hand, operationally, what happens is they say, well, okay, there's no better theory to replace it. But then if you start suggesting an alternative theory, they say, oh, no, that's crazy. That's unworkable. For one reason, because we haven't heard of it before. And so it sort of has a built-in stability.
Is that caused by the fact that a lot of these researchers have essentially their life's work on the line?
Sure. Yeah, but I mean, everybody has to make their choice. You know, if you're a researcher and you make a certain assumption, and you go ahead and base your life work on that assumption, well, you sort of have to take the consequences if you're not right.
So it's not necessarily science, then. It's people.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
Well, I'd like to thank Dr. Art for coming out this evening. He's in Ottawa to talk at the University of Ottawa, and he's extended his stay to come and present us a very interesting talk on his work. I read his book a number of years ago, and it's very interesting to see an update on further developments in the field. I know he's still having problems being accepted, but I think this is something that, judging from the questions we've had this evening, it looks like there's a lot of interest here, and I think we'll have a lot of interest in developments in the field in the future. So thank you very much for